to Math Homework Hotline, where we do the math. My name is Maggie Mixon, and with me tonight,
I am Canella Prado.
All right, so listen, we are so excited that you're on here with us. We have phones going off the hook. They are ringing because we have math students calling in since 5:30, and we want to hear from you. There's that phone number at the bottom of your screen, 813-840-7260. We have four teachers taking phone calls tonight. Any topic that you want to call in, so especially being Friday tomorrow, maybe you have a big assessment coming up or a little quiz, or you just want to check your understanding. You're like, man, I'm doing some homework and I need to make sure it's correct. So call in, talk to one of our math tutors and get you all squared away. Also, take us on the go because we are streaming live. So just go to any web browser that you have, mathhomeworkhotline.com, and take us on the go with you. I know some people have basketball games going on right now, for instance, or you know, you're going to cheer practice or whatever it may be, but we're going to be right there with you. We are doing the math.
Right.
All right. So what is tonight's topic, Ms. Canella?
Should we discuss the theme first? I don't know
the
if they can tell.
The theme and the topic, yes. The fun theme.
Buccaneers. That's Ooh. Right. We're celebrating that home opening win last weekend. And so we're off to a great season, 2-0, right? So celebrating the Bucs today.
Go Bucs.
Yeah. And a really quick shout out to my students, Gilberto and Brayden, for bringing in some props, giving me hat, all the lovely stuff up here. Thanks, guys.
Decking us all out.
Yeah.
Very cool. So, guys, every single show we have a fun theme, and then we also have a math topic of the night. So remember, you can call in with any math topic, but on air, you're going to see us working through a one particular math idea. All right? What is tonight's math topic?
Tonight's topic is Pythagorean Theorem. One of my favorites.
One of my favorites, too.
I know. The kids love it.
Yeah.
I got a song for it. I know you're surprised.
Oh, my goodness.
I have a song.
I cannot wait.
Okay.
All right. So one time I remember taking my students to from the classroom to the lunchroom, and they had to be reciting the formula for the Pythagorean Theorem. We won't make you do that tonight. Don't we fear. But by being the very first caller tonight, guys, when the challenge question is aired, you're going to see, take a quick picture of it, but it's going to relate to Pythagorean Theorem. So by you being the very first caller to answer the challenge question, you'll be able to win all sorts of goodies and prizes. But you got to call in, to first do the problem, obviously, know how to, you know, work it out, be able to explain it to someone on the phone, and then they'll put you on air with us. And if you're the very first person to do that, you'll be our very second Jimmy Award winner.
Ooh.
So are you ready for a challenge question? Do we hear
I
a challenge?
Am. I hear am. It. Let's see it.
Woohoo.
Okay, so tonight's challenge problem, get the camera out and take a quick photo, is if the right triangle's legs are both the same length, x, and the hypotenuse of the triangle is 25 feet, what is the value of x in feet? And please, round to the nearest tenth if necessary.
And there's a little picture there for them,
yep,
as a reference.
That's why they should take a quick screen grab.
Yeah, that's a good one, guys. All right, might be a little bit of a challenge, just like the problem, you know, is labeled challenge problem, but we know you can do it because this is how we do the math.
That's right.
All right, so Ms. Canella, what are they going to win?
Right, we should see what they're going to win. Well, they're going to win a lot.
Yes.
Okay. First of all, they're going to get this plaque, the Jemmy Award winner plaque. It'll have their name and their school on it.
Can I point out real quick, guys,
yeah.
This one says 2022. If you happen to... Yours will say 2023, we promise. It's
yes.
Just we're using last year's prop to be able to show you, you know, what it's going to look like, but with personalized
yours
to you.
Yours
will
be custom.
Exactly,
yes.
With the correct information.
Yes. And then, of course, you're going to get one of our new, fabulous, updated
Woo!
Math Homework Hotline t-shirts.
Let me see the back of that. Let me see.
Sure.
Let me see.
Ooh. A lot of the kids has got the time and all
the phone
numbers.
Number.
Yeah. And our sponsors there. And we are also going to give you, I love this little bag. It's perfect for like your gym clothes or just like a little overnight bag or beach bag, just when you need a little bag to carry things around.
I'm going to give you the goody.
This is the fun stuff here, which you kids, I know middle school kids, they're always starving. So you're going to get some gift cards for certain things at Chick-fil-A and McDonald's.
Plus.
I don't know what happens to the pencils in my classroom, but I'm pretty sure we have a pencil-eating monster. So you're going to get a pencil bag here that has some miscellaneous school supplies in it. And
for
then
teachers.
The teacher of the challenge winner will get an assortment of these pencil sharpeners, which will be great because then the kids are not running the electric pencil sharpener while you're trying to lecture.
And possibly even a lanyard.
And possibly even a lanyard. Ooh, look at this. It's got the, so you can open your, without removing your lanyard. I can't live without
these.
I can't.
So you guys, all sorts of goodies, and the teachers will also get a t-shirt themselves. So you can sport out their shirt. I know everybody's been wanting, that's a hot, you know, commodity around town, the swag for Math Homework Hotline. But from last week, our very first Jemmy winner of the season, this is our 30th season kickoff, you know, so show number two tonight. But last week we had someone very special to the show at Benito Middle School. There is the winner. That's Miss Lauren. She's in Miss Applegarth's class. And then our principal, Mr. Williams, he wanted to congratulate our student that won the Jemmy last week.
Awesome.
So she's, you know, super excited. She got all sorts of goodies, and she put her shirt on right away.
That's
and then
amazing.
We were, you know, taking a picture with the plaque and whatnot. So we encourage you, you be the first one tonight to call in, all right? With those shout-outs, we also want to say, teachers, you have a chance to win as well. So we have three shows in September, last week, this week, and next week. If you have this class with the highest number of phone calls, or if you're the teacher with the highest number of phone calls, we're keeping track of that as well. So you will get to get all sorts of goodies as well to join your students. All right. So, guys, lots and lots of shout outs. We are excited to be here with you during the Pythagorean Theorem. We already have a caller on the line, and it looks like it's from Miss Prado's class. So,
yes.
Miss Canella already has a caller. So, is this Catherine?
Yes.
Hey, Catherine. I wanted to ask you some questions before we get started, okay?
All right.
All right. So, tell me, this is going to sound silly the way I'm going to build this up, but what does a triangle look like if you had to explain it to someone?
I would say there are two long lines that go up together like a pyramid.
Oh.
And like the bottom
could
be shorter than the line or longer.
Okay. So on my board, I just drew what you described. I don't know if you could see my screen right now or our board, but you told me kind of like a pyramid, and then the base where you would connect the two bottoms or the two little peaks that are called your vertex. I'm going to tell you, if somebody didn't know, I would be happy with that description. So we have three sides, right? So this is just any kind of triangle. And we know triangles comes in different flavors and different sizes, basically. You have things like an isosceles triangle. Do you remember what that one was? That was a special kind of triangle? Isosceles. I'm not even going to try to spell that right this second. Isosceles triangle. When the two sides are equal, remember that?
Uh-huh.
So if let's say we use those little lines to say that two sides are equal, what happens if three sides are equal? I tried drawing that the best I could. Do you remember what kind of special name goes with that?
No.
No? So equilateral.
Yes. Right? Oh, equilateral.
Equilateral.
Yeah, sorry.
All right. So no, that's okay. But that's basically talking about the sides, right? So if two sides are equal, it's an isosceles. If all three sides are equal, it's an equilateral. And then what happens if all three sides are different sizes? That one was called a scalene. All right. So there's a special triangle, though, that I have drawn here before you called. If it has a little box to kind of label it, and it has something
right
special. Beautiful. So this is a right triangle. So when we talk about Pythagorean theorem, we always are going to use right triangles, right?
Yes.
So there's a very special formula that there's a mathematician by the name of Pythagoras. He discovered. So you have the leg of the triangle. Here's another leg. So we could just label those leg. So it's not going to walk away or anything like that, but those are called legs, the sides. And then what's the longest side called? Starts with an H. Give you a hint. So if I have two legs and it's a right triangle, there's a special name for that slanty side or the side that connects the two legs.
It's like diagonal, so...
Hypotenuse. That's maybe a new vocabulary word for you, okay? So I've noticed some classrooms where they put a hippopotamus laying down right there because the first four letters are the word hippo, right? But it's hypotenuse, and that's what we call the letter C. So normally, we just label the triangle, not a big deal, right? So the altitude or the height, A, the base or that bottom piece, B, and then the hypotenuse was C. And truly, it doesn't really matter where you put the legs as far as the labeling of them, because if you notice on our formula, that's the commutative property, right? Where you're adding and you could invert those two. So what you'll do is, when you have a right triangle, most of the time they're going to give you two of the sides, and then you have to find the missing one. So if this was, I'm going to ask you to set up the formula with me. So let's say that I had one of my legs was, give me a number, any number, from 1 to 10.
Five.
And let's say the other leg was another length. What do you want it to be?
Six.
All right. And we're going to call those inches because these are going to be measurements, right? So if I told you that one side of my triangle was 5 inches and the other side of the triangle was 6 inches, and I said, hey, I need you, Miss Catherine, to find me the hypotenuse of that triangle, you're going to say, aha, I have a trusty formula, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. So how would we use that formula with the information we're given?
Okay, well, we're going to do 5 squared.
Beautiful.
25. Mm-hmm. And then 6 squared would be 36.
Beautiful.
And then you would have to add 25 plus 36.
What do you get?
61.
61 is a great thing. So now 61 is equal to c squared. Am I going to put 61 right there for the length of the hypotenuse?
No. And I get 7.8.
My goodness. So you did basically the square root of 61. And I don't know about you, but I'm going to use my handy-dandy calculator, right? And I'm just going to make sure that when I put 61, I hit the square root button. Now, that's a long, giant decimal. So you told me 7.8?
Yeah, because I ran into the nearest 10.
Beautiful. And then we're going to say that's inches. What do you notice with that length of 7.8 as it compares to the others?
It's bigger.
Oh my goodness. I want to give you a huge shout out for getting all that done with me tonight. That was gorgeous math. Thank you, Miss Catherine, for calling in.
Okay, so good job there, Catherine.
Impressive.
Really impressive. So we're going to read the challenge question one more time because it has been requested.
Ooh.
We've had phone calls requesting it, so we're going to go ahead and do that. So let's put that back on the board, please. Okay, so if the right triangle's legs are both the same length of X, okay, so the legs A and B are both X, and the hypotenuse of the triangle is 25 feet, what is the value of X in feet? Round to the nearest tenth if necessary. So if you were paying attention to that warm-up, you should know what C is now.
Mm-hmm.
Should.
Let's see. We're going to see you do the math.
We're going to see you do the math on that one. So,
visible learning.
Okay, hopefully you got enough time now that you have got that photograph and can start working that challenge problem there. All right, so I have another question on my board. So we're going to say, what is the length of the hypotenuse in the triangle? So I wanted to talk about one of the ways you can identify, because sometimes kids get a little flustered. They're like, I don't know which side is the hypotenuse. I know that it's the longest side, but since I have no idea how long this side is, and this one looks really long too, how could I possibly know? Well, when you have this right angle, which here is indicated by this square, this right triangle square, it will always be opposite. Always opposite. So the legs always touch the right angle. See how they're both the legs. So this one, I'm going to call it A, and I'm going to call this one B. The truth of the matter is, and this one's C. Remember, C is opposite. The truth of the matter is, it doesn't matter which one is A or B because of the commutative property of addition. Mm-hmm. So I just kind of go with whichever one is first, but, you know, it doesn't matter is the main thing. So again, let's write down our formula of A squared
plus B squared.
Plus B squared equals C squared. So how I teach my kids to memorize this is, I don't know if they know the song or not, but most of the time they seem to have heard it once or twice in their life. There's a song called We Will Rock You by Queen.
We will rock you.
Okay,
so we
go.
Them.
Yes, exactly. So we go A squared plus B squared equals C squared.
Oh.
Okay? They do this and they stomp on the ground, because I don't know if you've ever heard that or not, but when they do We Will Rock You, they stomp, stomp. Okay.
Stomp,
so,
stomp.
A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Okay. And one time I was giving a test and I heard a student humming it.
Or geez.
Not singing.
Okay.
Just a hum.
Got it.
Humming. So wasn't cheating. And I thought, he is helping so many other people right now. Remember the formula. All right. So let's go back to the board.
Let's go back to the board.
So we have our A is 12. So we're going to do 12 squared plus 16 squared equals C squared. All right. So when we do 12 squared plus 16 squared, we're going to remember, just for a little quick review, that means 12 times 12. The exponent tells you how many times to take the base number times itself, essentially. So we're going to have 144, and then we're going to take 16 times 16, and we're going to get 256. Now, on the calculator, you can just take 16 times 16, but there's also this little squaring right here that would work. You could also do it by hand, but, you know, use the tools if you're given them. There's no problem with doing it by hand and then checking with the calculator. That's mm-hmm. always a good idea, right? Okay, and that's going to equal C squared. Now, the next step is we take 144 and we add 256, and we're going to get 400 equals C squared. And do you know what I see all the time in the classroom, Maggie?
What?
When it's multiple choice like this. Mm-hmm. The kids stop here and they choose 400.
Oh, no.
And of course, they put that 400 in there because they want to mm-hmm. see who knows how to solve all the way down. Right. We are trying to solve for C.
It doesn't make sense if you have 12 and 16.
Right, exactly. And we're trying to solve for C, right. Not C squared.
Right.
So how do we get a single C? We square root it.
Square root, which is Catherine, the opposite of squaring.
The opposite of squaring is square root. All right, so when we do that, that would give us C. And then you have to think to yourself, well, what number times itself would be 400? Now, you can certainly use your calculator, but I happen to have that one memorized. It's 20.
But wait a minute, because I could always do it backwards, too. 4 times 4 is 16. 20 times 20 is 400, because I'm given choices, right?
Mm-hmm, you could.
30 times 30.
That's a great idea. And I always tell the kids, you know, if you come up with a number that's not one of the choices,
ooh.
You can always plug and play.
Exactly.
Right?
Plug and play.
Plug and play. Substitute in. Okay, so then what we do is we just select the right one, which is our B here,
woo!
20. All right, so there you go. So some hints on how to remember which ones are the legs and which one is the hypotenuse.
That's a great hint, Ms. Camilla.
All right, Maggie, you got something special for us?
Yes, ma'am. So you guys, with Pythagorean theorem, there's so many different applications. So there's many different ways of using that formula, A squared plus B squared equals C squared. I will spare you from singing. So one of the ways that you could use it is by the question that I happen to have, which asked you, hey, you're given the three lengths of the sides of this rectangle, or not rectangle, rectangle is rectangle, like this, four sides. This triangle, think of the word tri, means three, right? So the prefix helps you with that. As I'm thinking here, I'm gonna be using this Pythagorean theorem. How can I use it to figure out if the side lengths are really gonna create a right triangle? Now, right triangles are really special because, just as Camilla showed you, those two legs come together to form a 90-degree angle. Well, one of the other ideas behind Pythagorean theorem is that if you get the two shorter legs, and you add them, so the sum, S-U-M, of shorter legs has to be greater than the hypotenuse, or the longest leg. All right? So that is a special idea that also comes with Pythagorean theorem. Okay, so the sum adding up the two shorter legs has to be greater than the longest leg, and then it'll create a right triangle. So let's try it out with the ones that we are given here. Now, not always is it going to be in order from least to greatest. So notice in C, they said 5, 4, 3. The other ones seem to be in order, so I wanted to pay special attention to that at first. All right, so let's test it out. So if I have 1 plus 2, because those are the two shorter or the two smaller numbers, is that going to add up and be greater than the longest side, which is 3? Well, 1 plus 2 is 3. Is 3 greater than 3? No way. It's equal to 3, but it has to be greater. It doesn't say greater than or equal to. It just says it has to be greater. So that one did not test out. So remove those numbers. Let's try the next set. Okay, which one are the two shorter legs? All right, Canella, which one are the two shorter legs?
2 and 4.
Two and four. So I'm going to add those two together. The longest leg?
6.
Six. So when I add 2 and 4 together, is that greater than 6?
No, it's equal.
It's equal. So that doesn't work either. Let's try two more sets of these. All right, and be careful, because if I just go in automatic pilot and I say, well, 5 plus 4 and 3, so 5 plus 4 is greater than 3. Well, yeah, that is true, but it has to go with the idea that the sum of the shorter legs, so the shorter legs are 3 and 4, is that greater than 5? Here it happens to be that it would have worked out either way, but 3 plus 4 is 7. 7 is greater than 5, so we know that that one does check out.
Now, guys, 3, 4, 5 is a Pythagorean triple, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. So what she means by a Pythagorean triple is that when we have a right triangle, maybe we're looking to see, do these numbers fit? So that creates a right triangle. 3, 4, 5, those, if that's something that you hear as a Pythagorean triple, that just means that it's a very popular side lengths for what you see there. All right, for Pythagorean theorem. This is one of those select all types of questions, guys. So we're gonna have to try out the last one too to make sure that it works. So 9 plus 12 are the two shorter sides. Is that greater than 15? And notice that I'm not even gonna do the math here, because I could already tell that 12 plus 9 is definitely gonna be greater than 15, because I only needed 3 more to get to 15, but I have 9. So that definitely works out as well. So just trying to think through and talk out loud how we do the math and be able to apply the Pythagorean theorem to not just finding one of the missing sides of that triangle, the right triangle. Given 3 lengths, I'm also being able to use it to determine if it is a right triangle.
I think we have
a challenge winner.
Hi, can you tell us your name? Hello?
Hello?
Hi, what's your name, please?
My name is Patel.
Okay. And you are from Williams, and you're in Miss Hunt's class, yes?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so let's see you show off those skills and win all these prizes tonight.
Let's multiply.
Okay, so it says, if a right triangle's legs are both the same length, x, and the hypotenuse of the triangle is 25 feet, what is the value of x in feet, round to the nearest tenth if necessary? So how did you set this up? Did you use a squared plus b squared equals c squared, sort of?
Yes.
Okay. Let's write that out just so the people at home can follow along with us. All right. So we don't really have an a and a b this time, do we?
No, we don't.
So what do we have instead?
We have x.
So how would we write this then?
So it would be squared plus squared
equals. Yes. All right. She's right. She said, we're just going to put in x squared because, yeah, see that? So x squared plus x squared. In this case, they just happen to be the same value. So next, what would you do? What's the next step?
So,
yeah, whenever there's nothing here, there's really a 1, right?
Coefficient of 1.
Right, coefficient of 1. Mm-hmm. So that you said you're going to combine those together, 1x squared plus 1x squared, and you got 2x squared. And then you, for c squared, you put in 25, right?
Yeah.
Right, that's what it says here on your board. Okay, so now what's the next step?
So the next is...
We're going to need to square that 25?
Yeah.
All right, do you got that total for me there? What's 25 times 25? You got that? 625. That is correct. 625. All right, now, a couple more steps, right?
Ooh, almost there.
I think two more steps. What's the next one?
So the next, you would square root, 125
by 2. That's right. It cut out, but she said we're gonna basically divide both sides by 2 so we can isolate x squared. And 625 divided by 2, what'd you get for that? 312.5. One last step. You got this. What is it?
X equals 7.
And how did you isolate x? What's that last step to get x all by itself? What'd you have to do?
You square root.
Yes, perfect.
31,500.
Right, so it's going to be x equals 17. And it said to round to the nearest tenth, so it's 17.67, but we're going to go with 17.7, right?
Yes.
17.7 feet. Excellent work. Miss Hunt is going to be crazy proud of you. And we'll be out soon with that big bag of prizes for you, okay?
You are our Demi winner for tonight.
That's right. Good job.
Guys, she did amazing. Love it. She did.
She did amazing.
Demi winners all over and winners all over the place, that your community as well, in your classrooms, in your schools. Don't forget to call in. We have another question that's going to be done with one of our students.
Looks like Jediah.
Can you tell me one more time?
Jediah.
Jediah?
Yeah.
Hey, how are you, miss?
I'm good.
That's awesome. I already have a question here on my board that we're going to work out using the Pythagorean theorem, okay?
Okay.
All right, here we go. So it says, what is the value of x? I have a triangle that happens to be a special right triangle. And one of the sides is 5, the other side is 10, and I'm looking for the hypotenuse.
Okay.
How do I start my problem? I'm going to start with the formula, okay? Because I always write the formula down, no matter how many times,
me
right?
Me too.
Exactly.
I love it.
Loving that formula. So what can we substitute in for the letters A, B, and C? So I have a 5, a 10, and an X. So where would I put those values?
So it has to be 5.
You want me to start with the 5?
Yeah, 5.
Where do you want me to put that in the place of what letter? A, B, or C?
A.
All right. I would go with that as well. All right. And let's do the 10 next. Where are you going to put the 10? In the B spot or the C spot?
The
B spot? All right. Yeah. I would agree with you as well. Now, how did you know that? I could hear myself in the background a little
yes.
bit. Can you lower the volume of your TV or where you're watching
yeah.
it? Yeah, no problem, honey. All right, so you beautifully substituted in the values for A squared, B squared, and C squared, or A, B, and C. The squares are still there. My question to you is, how did you know that the 5 and the 10 went in those two spots?
Because the X is the largest.
Beautiful. Exactly. So that X is the longest side or that hypotenuse. All right. So let's do the math here with us. What's 5 to the power of 2 or 5 squared?
25.
25. And what is 10 squared?
100.
Beautiful thing. Now, sometimes I have students who would say, no, 5 to the power of 2 is 10. That didn't get you. So I'm excited that you were not fooled by that. You remember exponents means a number times itself. So now we have calculated out the 5 squared, the 10 squared. We're getting ready to combine some like terms, and that's all equal to x squared, our hypotenuse. All right, what do I do next, honey?
Yes, x plus 5 together.
Very nice. And what do you get?
125.
All right, and that's equal to x squared. All right, last step that we've been showing throughout the evening or this show. How do we remove the square so it just becomes x all by itself, isolated x?
Divide by 2.
So instead of dividing by 2, let's think about what x squared means. It means x times x.
Oh, okay.
So how do you get rid of an x squared? What's the inverse of x squared? So it's like... So think of it like this. What number times itself is going to give me 125. It's not going to be an easy number because it's going to be a long decimal. So let's think about it. So let's kind of estimate a little bit. So first off, we know that 5 and 10, those are the numbers we do know. This is going to be our longest side that we're looking for. So we know the number is going to be bigger than 10, okay?
Okay.
So when you said divide by 2, that's because you were thinking, you know, there's a 2 there. I'm just going to split it in half. But that really is not what it means, right? The x squared means x times x. So a number times itself is going to have to equal 125. And we know that the number has to be bigger than 10. So for instance, 10 times 10 is 100. So it had to be bigger than that. What's 11 times 11?
121.
So we know it has to be bigger than 11 then, right? So what's 12 times 12?
144.
Very nice. So 12 times 12 is 144. And this number that we're looking for is in between those, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's really a lot closer to the 11 than it would be the 12. So this decimal is going to be 11 point something, all right? When I'm doing okay. this on my calculator, it's what I'm thinking of as a square root. So it's literally, I'm going to put 125, hit square root, and I get 11.1803, and it has a long, long decimal. But we were mm-hmm. right in estimating that if I put it to the nearest tenth, it's going to be 11.2 or 11 and 2 tenths. What do you think about that? Does that make sense?
Yes.
And then we always plug it back in to see if that does make it look like the longest side, which indeed it does check out. So excited that you did that problem with us. Thank you for calling, honey.
You're welcome.
You go, mathematicians.
Good job, Jediah. Way to stick in there and finish the problem.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, so we have t-shirt winners. Our brand new Math Homework Hotline t-shirt winners are Hayden from York, Asher from Benito, and Connor from Maniscalco. So these will be in the mail on their way to your math classroom. Thank you for calling in and supporting the show.
Very nice, guys. And also, if you notice our sponsors, one of them is EdGems, which is probably very familiar to you because of the fact that our textbooks for grades 6 through 8 math are from EdGems. Our sponsors are the ones that also have the Gemmy Award, right? But also, we wanted to point out a special feature that are within our workbooks. Are you ready for the gem of the night? Here is a unit review.
Oh, yes.
And I definitely wanted to show you this because this time of year, we're noticing that we're getting closer to finishing certain units of study. For instance, in 7th grade, I think we're working in Unit 2 and finishing that up. But really, that unit review is within your consumable book. It's a good way for you to check your understanding, that targeted practice for assessment. Definitely located in the workbook, but also on your digital textbook. And it's just a really great way to see the review of those key skills and concepts, you know, just closely modeled questions that are going to help you see, you know, do you really get this or not, to show your understanding and that assessment, not only for yourself, but for your teacher. So remember that you can get that online as well. And if you notice, it's also available in Spanish. So it's part of our Spanish resources. Very interactive. You can help, you know, yourself and then also give yourself an idea of, hey, do I need to study a little bit more on this particular kind of question or not? And show your family and be so proud of the fact that you can do those. Nice review and a nice assessment. So the unit review on the back of each unit, use it. Help yourself be able to say, hey, look at all the stuff that I know. So show what you know.
I definitely use the unit reviews 100%. And, you know, Miss Prado is a digital gal, save the trees. But actually, I use the paper review.
You do?
I do. This is the one time because I like to see all of that workout when my kids are doing the review. I like to see all of those details in that. So, but to each their own, whatever works for your teacher and your classroom is what's best for you. But it's one of the rare times that I leave the world of digital and go back to the old-fashioned way. So it's nice to have both resources available. We really appreciate that, EdGems. Okay, so I have a question.
Yay!
Okay, so it's a word problem. Dun, dun, dun. And I tell kids all the time, they're like, oh, I don't want to. The more you practice them, the better you get at it. So let's practice one here on TV today. All right, so the side lengths of a right triangular flag are 3 feet, let me get a different color, 3 feet and 5 feet. And I'm going to say, I'm also going to say triangular flag. What is the length of the hypotenuse? Hypotenuse. Oh, we have someone on air. Would they like to join me? Okay. Hi, is this Matthew?
Yes, it is.
Hi, can you tell us what school you're from?
I'm from Collins
K-8.
All right. Awesome. Okay. I see that now. It's at the very top. All right. So, Matthew, we're going to work a word problem about right triangles using Pythagorean theorem to do the hypotenuse. So stick with me, okay? I'm going to read the whole problem again to get you caught up. The side lengths of a right triangular flag are 3 feet and 5 feet. What is the length of the hypotenuse? And we're going to round to the nearest tenth if necessary. So what I tell my kids always with word problems, if you can draw it, draw it. And look, it says right triangular flag right here. Right triangular flag. Here we go. Those keywords. So I'm going to draw it. I'm going to draw a right triangular flag. Now, it's not going to be gorgeous because Ms. Prado's not that good at drawing triangles freehand. But there's our right triangular flag. And I'm drawing the little right. The square here indicates that it's a right triangular flag. So it says that we're going to try to find the hypotenuse. So the hypotenuse, I told you earlier, is always across from the right triangle, from the right angle, sorry. So that's going to be this side, okay? That side is going to be called C. What are our other two measurements that are going to go in here? Can you see the word problem?
Yes, I can.
Okay, so what are the other numbers? Three, and what's the other one?
Five.
Yep, and I'm going to say that 3 is A and 5 is B. You could switch those. It doesn't matter because the commutative property of addition. But let's do this. Ready? So we're going to sing. I'm going to sing the song. You don't have to sing with me. It's A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Okay? All right. Mm-hmm. So what number, what did we decide A was? What number is that?
It's, I believe, 3.
3. 3 squared, and then our B is 5.
B.
Okay, and then we're working for C squared, right? That's what we're going for. Do you know Do you know how to find 3 squared?
Well,
what you would want. So 3 squared is 3 times 3. What's 3 times 3?
That's 9.
9.
Okay. And then C squared is... So 5 times 5.
Yep, and what's that equal? 5 times 5 equals 25.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so now we're going to have to add, the next step is to add, right?
Uh-huh.
So what's 9 and 25?
9 plus 5 would equal 34.
Perfect. All right, so now we have 34 equals C squared, and a lot of kids will mistakenly stop here. But we need to have one C, not C squared.
Uh-huh.
So the opposite of squaring is what?
I would assume you have the square root.
Square root, perfect. Yeah. You are killing this, Matthew. Amazing. All right, so when we take 34 and we square root it, what are we going to get? Do you have a calculator handy?
Because the calculator,
okay. All right. So what did you get?
I've actually never used.
That's okay.
We'll teach you.
Okay. So on the TI 30.
I'm pretty sure. It
gets 5.8. Yes. Very nice.
Right. It's 5.8. Three. 5.831, mm-hmm. But we said round to the nearest tenth, right? So you're right. Yeah. We're just going to go with 5.8 equals C. And this would be, this, and our units would, we could look back up here and see our units would be feet. So C would equal 5.8 feet. And does that follow our rule that C has to be the longest side?
Yes, it does.
Yes. Perfect. Yes. Thank you, Matthew, for doing an amazing job tonight.
Yes.
Excellent work. Really impressed.
Very
Thank
nice,
you,
guys.
Matthew.
We also have Ms. Adley on the line with us. How are you, Adley?
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Ms. Prado just started doing some word problems, and I couldn't contain myself. I want to do some word problems, too, because those are so exciting, because it's the real world, right? Something that maybe you would consider. All right, so let's see, because math is everywhere. We're going to have a construction worker, and we're going to be putting some things, you're going to notice in the problem. We're going to be talking about a window and a ladder and basically putting it up against the house, okay, this ladder. Let's read the problem so we can get an idea of what we're going to find. The construction worker needs to install a window. So I'm thinking here's a house, there's a window, all right? And in that window, remember houses have windows. Let's pretend it's one of those little houses that, you know, that has the door. Those windows are very disproportional. All right. But the ladder is 13 foot. So he says he placed a 13-foot ladder at the window opening. So somehow we're going to have this ladder, right, that's going to be at the window opening. And my drawing could use a little bit of work, but I'm just trying to get a little sketch.
I thought it was super impressive.
Of what was happening here. All right, so we're going to put up this ladder. And they're telling me the ladder is 13 feet. And then they're also telling me that the window is 12 feet up the wall. So I'm trying to get an idea of what's going on. And I'm literally going to have what I'm thinking to myself, a triangle of some kind. Here's my ladder up against the window. This is the window up here, the window opening. Here's the house, if you will. And it's saying that the window is 12 feet up. So if I noticed my numbers where I'm placing them, ladder, up the window up from the house. So those are my three sides. And now the question's going to become, how far away from the house is the ladder, or the base of the ladder, okay? So this is the side that I'm looking for. So far, we've been showing you a lot of questions where we find the hypotenuse, or the longest side, and that's not the case with this particular question, okay? So it's gonna stretch you a little bit. Here we go. So 13-foot ladder, window's up 12 feet, and then we gotta find the distance in feet of how far it is that this ladder is placed from the wall, all right? I think you're up for this challenge. Let me get some board space so we can definitely do that. Let's start with our Pythagorean theorem. Remind me what that is.
A squared plus B squared equals C squared.
Beautiful thing. And Miss Adley on fire. What am I going to replace the A and the B and the C with?
So the A will be 12.
All right.
B will be X.
All right.
And C will be 13.
Totally agree with you. And what's next, ma'am?
So you got a... square, mm-hmm. A, and C.
Very nice. So what is 12 to the power of 2, or 12 squared?
12 squared is 144.
Very nice. So 12 times 12 is 144. I'm just going to bring the X squared down because that's exactly what I'm trying to find. And what's 13 to the power of 2, or 13 squared?
13 squared is 169.
Beautiful thing. All right, so we haven't seen this necessarily yet. Now that we have the squares that we know the numbers for done, what happens next? Tell me.
We gotta subtract A from C.
Very nice. So we're going to take the 144 and move it over to where the 169 is and subtract, right? Now, the little label at the bottom that says call 813-840-7260 doesn't let you see that necessarily. But we're going to do the 169, take away 144, right?
Yeah.
And what are we going to get with that?
You're going to get 25.
25. It's a beautiful thing. We love calculators as well to use our tools to check ourselves. But that one, when I've set it up vertically, doesn't look so bad, right? So now what I see here happening is that X squared is equal to the subtraction of those big numbers, right, to get 25. So now I have to think to myself, X squared means what?
Means X times itself.
Exactly. So X times X. So what number times itself is going to give me 25?
5.
You got it. You sounded a little surprised, but I think you got this, and you're our champion for math. So let's make sure that it's reasonable, though, right? I always like to go back and check. So these units are all in feet, so that's a good thing. The number that we found was how far the ladder was from the house. So we said 5 feet. Does that go along with the numbers that we're given?
Yeah.
It does sound right to me as well. It's very reasonable. You got a beautiful check mark, Miss Adley. Thank you for calling in tonight, ma'am.
Good job, Adley. So 5, 12, and 13 is a Pythagorean triple as well.
Exactly.
And this week we were working a problem in my class, and I have to tell the story because it's adorable. So the answer ended up being 6, 8, 10, which is another Pythagorean triple. And my student, Trey, yelled out, "That's my favorite Pythagorean triple."
Aww.
And then I began to realize that I didn't have one. So my goal is by the test day, which is Tuesday,
you're going to
have my favorite Pythagorean triple. As all math teachers should have a favorite one, right?
Mine's 3, 4, 5.
Yours is 3. It's a good one.
It's little numbers.
It's a good one. Okay, let's go. Oh, wait, I think we have a caller. Is this Talia?
Hello.
Hi, Talia. You're from Miss Applegar's class at Benito?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right. Let's do one of these problems. Okay? Let's go to the board.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm going to show you a triangle on the board. Let's go to the board and look at that one. It's a beautifully drawn triangle, especially by me. We need, that's right, we're going to the board. Okay, so sometimes they like to trick you. You know that? Sometimes they're a little bit of stinkers, and they like to trick you. And they said, find the value of X, right? And some kids, some kids might not realize that they have to figure out, this is the X down here. Some kids may not realize that they have to figure out if X is A, B, or C. What do you think it is? Do you think it's A, B, or C? X. Do you remember what I said earlier? You may have been on hold and not heard, but the ones that touch the right angle, those are the legs. And the one across.
Across from it, diagonal.
Yeah, so yes. What is that one?
Yes.
That would be the C, really, right? So that's the hypotenuse. They just turned it upside down, didn't they? They just flip.
Yes.
They just flip. Mm-hmm. They do. They love to do that. They love to do that.
They're trying to test what you know.
They love to do that, and that's okay because they can't trick us. Not tonight, no sir. Okay. All right.
Nope.
So we're gonna go. We're gonna sing that song. A squared plus B squared equals C squared. There you go. Yeah. So what's our A? What value are we gonna make A?
We are going to make 8 squared A.
Okay, 8 squared, and then you're going to say that 15 is B, right?
Yes.
Okay, and that's going to equal C squared. Do you know what 8 squared is off the top of your head? You got it? It's okay.
Yes.
Okay, what is it?
So 8 squared would be 64.
Beautiful.
Correct. And what would be 15 squared?
225.
Beautiful. Excellent, excellent work. Now, what's our next step? We squared the numbers we have, so what's our next step?
Our next step is to add the numbers.
You cannot fool her tonight.
Very nice.
Miss Applegarth puts out some super smart kids here.
Angel is rocking it.
All right, so what do you do? 64 plus 225 is what?
289.
Beautiful.
Woo, woo, woo.
All right, again, this is where they'll always trick you on multiple choice. They'll include 289. But
yes.
We know we don't need C squared. We need just C. So what's our last step?
We have to undo the square. We have to square root.
We have to square root to get C by itself. And do you know what the square root of 289 rounded to the nearest tenth is?
17.
Very nice.
Yeah. That must have been a perfect one, right?
It was.
All right. I don't know, but she did perfect. I
she
can tell you
beautiful.
That much right now. Thank you so much for calling in with my upside down, tried to trick you triangle, but did not get away with it.
Yes. So Angel's on the line with us as well. Hey, Angel.
This is Angel from Strawberry Crest.
Strawberry Crest.
Very nice.
Are you there, Angel?
Yes.
Hey, we have one last way to be able to look at Pythagorean Theorem that we have not discussed tonight, and it's basically looking at the distance between two points on a coordinate plane. Are you ready to do that math with me?
Yes.
Awesome. Let's do it. So on my board, you're going to notice that I have a little bit of a description, and then I started drawing it for us so like that we could get a head start. So use the Pythagorean Theorem to find the distance between negative 2, 2 and negative 8, negative 4. So that ordered pair, I just went ahead and I drew my X and my Y axes and I plotted those, the negative two to the, you know, two to the left, up two, eight to the left, down four. But now we want to use the Pythagorean Theorem, this is what the directions say, to be able to find the distance between those two points. Where do you think we're going to start? Like once I have it drawn like this.
I would start at the...
At the negative 8, negative 4?
The negative 2 and 2.
Oh, negative 2 and 2? Okay, what do you want me to do from there?
Go over.
Mm-hmm. So go over how many spaces?
Five.
Beautiful. And why did you go over five?
You go down.
Mm-hmm.
Four.
All right. So you went down four. So you had, you're basically trying to figure out if I can make a triangle, you could either do it going sideways, right? And then down, like you were describing to me. Or yes. You go down first and then over to the right. So over to the left and down, or over to the right and up, right? So yes. I just wanted to show that the distance between those two points can be our hypotenuse. If we end up making a triangle, which in either direction, it's going to make a right triangle, right?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So we got to find the legs. If we're the big idea is that we're going to have to figure out what the C is, the hypotenuse. But on a grid like this, we already know the legs. All right. So what is that distance from side to side? So here, if I'm at over negative 2 and over at negative 8, how far over is it from negative 2 to negative 8? What's that distance? Which is the same at the top or the bottom. All right. So I'm thinking, if you notice, negative 2, if I count negative 3, negative 4, negative 5, negative 6, negative 7, negative 8, I'm actually jumping 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay? So one of these legs is going to be 6. Now, if I go down, I'm already above the y or the x-axis on the y, I'm at 2, and I'm going to go all the way down to negative 4, right?
Yes.
So what's that distance going to be?
That is going to... Wait, what was it?
So you're going to have 6 again, right? Because you're above the axis by 2, and you're below the axis by 4, right?
Yes.
All right.
That
would be... So I have a triangle that looks like the legs are 6 and 6. I put the 6 in the wrong spot, got carried away. So I was just drawing it over here on the grid, so we had an idea of what the lengths were, the legs were, okay?
Yeah.
So I had used C before. I used X in my equation here, so I'm just going to remove that so it's consistent. Beautiful. Now what do we do? Since we now have, you know, a lot of that hard work has already been done for us, right?
Yes.
Now we're going to plug into that Pythagorean theorem, which I trust you know that formula, right? A squared plus B squared equals C squared.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, let's plug it in and let's do the work. It's all you. Go, Angel.
It's B plus 6 squared equals C squared.
Very nice. So 6 squared plus 6 squared equals C squared. Now what happens?
You would 6 squared equals 36.
Beautiful. So it sounds like I'm going to do that twice, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So 36 added to 36 has to equal C squared. What happens when I get 36 and 36 together?
You would get some.
72. Beautiful. So 72 is C squared. And then what do I do as my very last step?
You would...
So the opposite of squaring a number is? So think of it as a square root. All right. So this one, again, is not a perfect square, but the square root of 72. So what number times itself is going to give me 72? That's going to be a decimal, but we know it's going to be bigger than 8, smaller than 9, right? Because of estimating with perfect squares. So when I did this actually with my scientific calculator, because I wanted to be exact, I said C is equal to 8.5 if I round to the nearest hundredths, or not hundredths, yeah. Tenths. Apologize for that. It's a long decimal that goes way beyond the hundredths place. All right, Angel, thank you so much for calling in. That was amazing.
The time has flown, but it's time for more T-shirt winners.
Yay!
All right, we've got Ivan from Mulrennan, Laura from Walker, and Matthew from Collins.
Very
thank you
nice.
For calling in. You get this new exciting T-shirt. They're on their way soon to your math class.
Yes, ma'am. All right, you guys, and that also, we have another great sponsor for our Math Homework Hotline show, Mathnasium. If you notice that on the screen, you're going to see all the different locations that they have. But Mathnasium is a proud sponsor of Math Homework Hotline. And they do ask you to come in to do a or schedule a free assessment. You can actually call them. And I will tell you that their priority this year and always has been math. So you're going to discover why millions of parents have trusted Mathnasium to transform students' math skills and build that confidence. But instruction is definitely offered both in person and online. By all means, notice Brandon, Carrollwood, New Tampa, Riverview, South Tampa, West Chase. There's a location near you. Call them. Schedule that free assessment because you see that A plus in red. That's going to be you, A plus plus on every question that you do.
That's right. Okay, I think I can squeeze in really quick one more little word problem. Let's do this one. This one comes up frequently and kids sometimes get a little confused, so let's spell it out for them. All right, the diagonal measure of a picture frame, look at my beautiful picture frame.
Beautiful.
Is 8.6. The frame is 5 inches wide. What is the approximate length? So now what kids do is they go, I don't understand what this has to do with Pythagorean theorem. Well, it has a lot to do. If we draw that diagonal, which I've already done for you here, and label it 8.6, and then we've got the bottom, the width here, look at that, is 5. Then guess what? The length becomes what? A leg of a right triangle. See that there? So we've got a leg of a right triangle. So we can use A squared plus B squared equals C squared. That's right. All right, so now I'm going to label this side A and this one B, okay? And then, of course, the one across from the right right triangle square is C. Okay, so we're going to plug it in. We don't know what A squared is, but we know that B is 5 squared, and we know that C is 8.6 squared.
Those are ugly numbers.
You think so?
Because it's a decimal.
Oh, because it's a decimal.
That's
well,
okay.
We're not that desperate yet. No. Okay, all right. So we're going to say that A squared...
25.
5 times 5, 25, and 8.6.
I want to do it. Okay. 8.6 times 8.6 is 73.96.
Yes. All right. So now, Maggie,
we
have to get variables on one side, constants on the other.
Yes. So subtract 25.
We're going to subtract 25 from both sides.
48.96.
That's right. 48.96 equals A squared. All right, and then our last step, Maggie, is to what?
Square root it.
And we're going to get A equals?
Okay, I'm going to need you to write this whole thing out real quick. 6.9971, and then dot, dot, dot.
Dot, dot, dot. Okay, but it said approximate.
Yes.
So I feel comfortable with rounding to?
Seven.
7 inches. Yes. There you go. All right, so let's say goodnight real quick. Let's wrap up. We'll be seeing you in 1 week. We will be doing percents and probabilities, and our theme will be the Rays.
Go Rays. Go Rays.
Okay, and go Bucks this weekend.
Yes, ma'am. Have a good night, you guys. We'll see you doing the math all over Hillsborough County Schools because we are math strong and Hillsborough strong. All right. Have fun. Enjoy. We will definitely get those shirts out to you. And thank you for calling in tonight. Thank you for watching.
Thanks again to Hayden and Gilberto for all my little pretties for the set. Thank you, guys.
All right. And congratulations to all you winners tonight. All of us are winners. And we are so excited to hear from you. All right. Talk soon.
Later.